When she was a little girl, Airi Katsuta moved with her family from Japan to Phoenix. Last summer, the ASU photography major returned to Japan to volunteer for tsunami relief efforts. And along the way, she captured images of devastation and hope. And now she's making and selling 1,000 origami cranes to raise money for a return trip to Japan. Joining me now is Airi Katsuta. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
The idea of going over there, well, first of all, where were you when the quake and the tsunami hit?
I was in my home in Awatuki, and I was working on my paper, actually, and then I saw it on the news, and my sister and my mother were actually in Japan when it happened, and I just couldn't believe my eyes.
Yeah. What were your first thoughts?
It was just... I was speechless. I didn't know what to say. It was just all the black waves just coming into the city and taking everything away.
And you moved, obviously, how old were you when you came to America?
When I was 6 years old.
6 years old. So you do have memories, and you had kind of a grounding in Japan. When did you decide you had to go back over there? You had to go help?
My sister actually volunteered earlier on, and she told me how amazing her experience was, and I felt like I needed to help out, and it's my country, so, you know.
And where did you go when you went over?
I went to Ishinomaki, which is in Miyagi Prefecture, and it's about 100 miles away from the nuclear power plant.
100 miles away, and what did you see when you got there?
Just every, rubble and cars just flipped over, and mud everywhere.
We have some of your photographs we want to take a look at. You mentioned cars flipped over. The first photograph we're looking at, that's a car. Is that a graveyard?
Yeah, and we actually couldn't move it with a bulldozer or a crane because we didn't want to destroy the tombstones.
The next shot shows kind of a wide panoramic view of what looks to be, that's flooded, that's water. That's an entire region sitting underwater, correct?
Yeah, and that's actually the ocean from far, and everything was just gone.
When you take a picture like that one, do you have to, sometimes with photography, just putting that piece of metal between you and what you're shooting gives you a little bit of separation, maybe a little bit of sense of distance. Did you feel that at all?
I did. The first week I was there, it was so hard for me to photograph it, and just taking it in with my own eye was just too much.
What do you look for in a photograph, especially in a scene like that? You're a photography major, so obviously you've done different things with photographs, but with something like this, what do you look for?
Just my feeling. I go with my gut.
Do you really?
Uh-huh.
Well, this next photograph is beautiful, and it's touching, and it's got a couple of folks that are literally looking out on devastation. I mean, did you have a chance to talk to these folks, and what did you hear from them?
They were telling me about where they used to go shopping at, where they used to take their walks, and just telling me their memories of this place.
Did you see in those kinds of folks, was there desperation, was there sadness, was there courage, was there hope? What did you feel?
They were not acting like victims at all, and they were so positive and so ready to move on and start rebuilding and recovering.
Was that what you expected? Was that a little bit of a surprise?
Yeah, it was. I thought people were going to be crying and, you know, just being sad about their homes being gone, but they were just positive.
We have another photograph here. Again, this looks like it's got some sort of cemetery feel to it, and then nothing but devastation. I mean, it must have been everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And when you see a shot like this, just get back to photography elements here. What are you trying to say with this photograph?
That there's flowers in the front, and that people are still coming in to, you know, just show hope.
Show hope, mm-hmm. Yeah. And the next photograph shows, again, one of these dichotomies of what looks to be a graveyard cemetery and absolute devastation, and then you've got other buildings in the background. Mm-hmm. Does a shot like, do you walk up and say, I got it? Or you just take a shot like that, and when you develop later, you go, ooh, I got it?
That one especially, I knew it when I shot it.
You knew it?
Mm-hmm.
Because you saw it and you said, I got to get that one.
Yeah.
The last photograph here is interesting. I couldn't quite make out what this was. What are we looking at there?
It's teruteru pose, which is a traditional, handmade amulet that kids make in Japan, and they make it to stop the rain or hope for a sunny day.
Oh, interesting. Well, that would obviously be a wonderful photograph. Then we go from that to you trying to raise funds now to get back. Why do you want to go back?
I feel that it's very important for me to return there. I hope for every year to see the recovery process.
Do you want to document again with photographs?
Yes, I do.
Now, to raise the money, are you making origami cranes?
Yes, I am.
Let's show us what you got there.
This is a printing process called cyanotypes. That's the design on the paper. And I folded 1,000 of them. And they say that if you make 1,000, your wish will come true. Not for materialistic things, but for good health and good luck. So I wanted to wish that.
Let me see this for a second here so we can get a shot of it on the camera. That is absolutely gorgeous. How long does it take to make something like that?
It took me a couple months to do all 1,000 of them because I have to cut the paper, print it, and wash the paper, fold it, string it, just so much to do.
And the paper looks like it's blue, but it's got like a little feathery kind of a look mm-hmm. to it as well. And that was design.
Mm-hmm.
Origami, have you always been interested in origami? Or?
Yeah, and most Japanese kids learn how to fold cranes when they're little. It's just something that we know how to do. At least it was for me.
How many you sold so far?
Right, as of now, I've raised $2,441.
Well, that's pretty good, mm-hmm. don't you think?
Yeah.
A lot of origami cranes flying uh-huh. around there, aren't there? What does your family think of all this?
They're very proud of me, and they're really excited about this project coming together.
And so when you go back now and you go back to take photographs, will you help with relief efforts as well? Or has that pretty much been moving along to where that's not necessarily needed right now?
They still need volunteers, and they depend on volunteers to come to do the recovery process. But I already did that, and I think it's more important for me to use my skill as a photographer and spread awareness. And I didn't want to do, you know, volunteering and photographing like at the same time and do everything halfway.
Sure.
So I wanted to focus on one thing and document it.
Did this before all this happened now, before the quake and the tsunami, were you kind of one person? And afterwards, are you a different person?
I am.
How so?
I feel more connected to my Japanese roots now. And since I've been living here for so long, I kind of lost touch of it. But after being there, feeling all the positive energy, I learned to not care about the little things and realize how short life is.
Isn't that something? Well, congratulations. You're doing great work. Good luck with the origami crane. They're beautiful.
Thank you.
Absolutely gorgeous. And thank you for the photographs as well. And good luck. We wish you the best.
Thank you.
Thank you.